Welcome to Ben Franklin's World, a podcast about early American history with Liz Covart. The study of history is key to understanding who we are and how we can affect a better future. Ben Franklin's World will introduce you to historical people and events that have impacted and shaped our present-day world. And now, here's your host, Liz Covart.
Hello, and welcome to Episode 5 of Ben Franklin's World, the podcast dedicated to helping you learn how the people and events of our early American past have shaped the present-day world we live in. Each week, we sit down with an historian to discuss their unique insights into our early American past so we can learn more about who we are and how we can affect a better future. I'm excited about today's episode because today we're going to dive into the topic of 18th century medicine. Now, you've likely heard of the names of George and Martha Washington, John and Abigail Adams, and James and Dolly Madison. I'm sure you know they're the names of some of the founding fathers and mothers of the United States. But did you know that all of these couples experienced tragic and sometimes frequent bouts of illness and disease? Or that their experience with disease and illness affected their lives, and in the case of the founding fathers, their political agendas? Today, we're going to chat with Jeannie Abrams, professor at the University of Denver University Libraries. Using examples from her recent book, Revolutionary Medicine, The Founding Fathers and Mothers in Sickness and in Health, Jeannie shares insight into the world of 18th century medical knowledge. She'll help us understand what Americans living in the 18th century understood about disease and how to prevent it, what the most common diseases of the 18th century were and more information about them, and how disease and illness affected the specific lives and families of George and Martha Washington, John and Abigail Adams, James and Dolly Madison, Thomas Jefferson, and Benjamin Franklin. So without further ado, here's our conversation with Jeannie.
With tidings and wisdom to share about our early American past, here is this week's special guest.
Today, we welcome Jeannie Abrams. Jeannie is a professor at the University of Denver University Libraries, where she serves as the director of the Beck Archives and the Rocky Mountain Jewish Historical Society. Jeannie has authored numerous books and articles, including Jewish Women, Pioneering the Frontier Trail, A History of the American West, and, most recently, Revolutionary Medicine, The Founding Fathers and Mothers in Sickness and in Health. Welcome to the show, Jeannie.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be with you today.
And we're excited you're here. So why don't we start the show by having you tell us a little bit about yourself and your historical interests, perhaps what made you want to become a historian?
Well, it goes back quite a few years. I took advanced placement history in high school, which enabled me to jump right into history in college. And my very first course as a freshman was a class in colonial American history, and my first major assignment, my first paper, was an essay on loyalists in the American Revolution, and I was sent to the New York City Historical Society. I was overwhelmed when they handed me letters that were composed by American loyalists that had been written, 200 years, a little more previously. And it really launched me on a lifelong love affair with primary sources.
Wow, the New York Historical Society. I've been there. That's an incredible place to walk into your first archive and work.
It was indeed. And you can tell how long ago it was because I don't even recall having to put on any gloves or anything like that.
Yeah, today wearing gloves or protective materials is sometimes standards depending on the archive.
Certainly original letters from several hundred years prior.
So Jeannie's latest book is Revolutionary Medicine, The Founding Fathers and Mothers in Sickness and in Health. Jeannie, can you tell us a little bit about your book and what drew you to the topic of medicine and the founding fathers and mothers?
Well, I've had rather, I would say, an eclectic writing history, as you mentioned in the introduction. I've done a lot of work on Jews in the American West, particularly women. But I started out in early American history, and my doctoral dissertation actually was connected with medical history. Over the last couple of years, last decade really, become more involved in medical history. I've always been an avid reader of biographies, particularly those of the founders. I can't tell you exactly when I had the epiphany, but I think I was reading an article about George Washington and his final illness, and that triggered the idea of looking at some of the early founders from a slightly different viewpoint, looking at them in terms of medicine in the 18th century and their own personal medical biographies.
Yeah, that's really interesting. You know, the founders, a lot of people get their into history, in American history at least, by reading biographies of the founders and trying to understand their personal lives. Now, I think in order to really talk about your book, it would be helpful if we knew how 18th century people understood how to promote health, treat illness, and to prevent disease. How did people in the 18th century understand how to do those things?
Well, truthfully, medicine in the 18th century in many ways had not progressed much from Galen in the early centuries. Most physicians at the time viewed good health as a balance of the four bodily humors, blood, phlegm, black and yellow bile, and they attributed illnesses to a disalignment of those four sources. So some of the main types of treatment revolved on getting the body back into alignment. So bleeding, for example, bloodletting was considered essential for the treatment of many diseases, even though as we look back in retrospect, it obviously did very little or nothing to help any of those diseases. Remember, too, that in the 18th century, and we have to look at medicine on its own terms in their time, we were really centuries before the discovery of germ theory. So they had very little idea of the sources of disease, how they were transmitted, and their tools were limited. That being said, a number of physicians would be, I would say, a little more forward-thinking, and surprisingly, many of the founders, or perhaps unsurprisingly, a number of the founders had some very good workable ideas about prevention of illnesses. Benjamin Franklin, for example, had at least a rudimentary idea of what we would call contagion in terms of colds. He believed very strongly in the efficacy of fresh air and that it would mitigate transferring some illnesses from people one to another.
Yeah, that was when he left the window open during one of his trips with John Adams, and John Adams was not so thrilled about that, was he?
That's really, I think, a wonderful, iconic story. John Adams recounted in his diary that he and Franklin traveled together to the Continental Congress at one point, and they roomed together, and Franklin was really manic about fresh air and insisted on keeping the windows open. And Adams, like most people at the time, felt that cold air was harmful to people. So I guess they spent quite a bit of the night opening and closing, like a married couple opening and closing the windows. And Adams recalled that finally, after Franklin harangued him with a lecture on the benefits of fresh air, he was finally so bored he fell asleep.
Yeah, it's a great story, and I love picturing how this all went down in their tavern room.
They were really quite really such strong magnetic personalities, both of them very, very different types of personalities.
Do you happen to know how far back when this idea of equilibrium and humors and bile, how far back that dates? Like, when did, you know, how did the people?
Yes, we're going all the way back to Hippocrates and all the way back really to the 2nd century and through the 4th century. So very, very little changes about that. There was more emphasis during the 18th century, starting to look more at empirical science and observation. But still, they spent a great deal of time trying to tie illness to weather conditions, negative particles in the atmosphere, miasmas, feeling that many diseases really arose from bad air. It's fascinating to me that malaria, which was one of the most common diseases in early America, the etymology of the word is malaria, Latin, bad air. So they felt that there were these harmful particles emanating either from the earth or the atmosphere or swamps in particular that caused disease.
And because you mentioned it, there were a lot of common diseases in colonial America. So malaria is just one. What were the other common diseases and which do you think was the most deadly?
Well, the ones that are most dramatic that we have heard the most about, of course, would be smallpox. Tremendous epidemic from about 1775 through the next 10 to 15 years that killed over 100,000 people in North America. Measles was actually a serious disease at the time. And as I said, malaria, yellow fever. But probably the greatest killer were killers were really respiratory diseases, common bronchitis, pneumonia. Remember, the 18th century was really an era where some of the hallmarks of modern medicine had not even been conceived of. Things that we take for granted today, the three A's, antibiotics, antiseptics, anesthesia, were really unknown.
It sounds like I don't know. I don't know if I want to travel back to the 18th century, given how much disease there might, you know, there was definitely there.
What's really fascinating and so impressive to me is I think even historians have trouble getting their arms about what life was like in the 18th century in terms of health. Obviously, we still have disease and death with us today. But the founders were really bombarded with illnesses and disease, they themselves, in their communities, in their families. And often they had devastating effects on the families of the founders. So I think it's even really more impressive that they were able to devote themselves to the good of the nation and politics.
Now, you mentioned smallpox, and smallpox figures throughout many of your chapters. Could you tell us what smallpox is and then how so many of the founders managed to avoid contracting it or how they survived it if they did contract it?
Yes, smallpox was really one of the greatest scourges, plagues of the age. It was a virus. It was passed from person to person. Some of the founders, well, first of all, I should backtrack and say those who survived smallpox had lifelong immunity. So one way that some of them avoided smallpox is that they obviously had cases that they had overcome. But it became more and more popular. Inoculation was introduced really by, I would say, some of the early leaders in America. Cotton Mather was a very prime example. He was a great advocate for inoculation. But inoculation had some dangers, and it did have a mortality rate depending on how it was administered. But it was somewhere, I would say, around 5, perhaps in 100 people would contract such a severe case of smallpox from the inoculation that they would die. But it involved inserting live human virus under
this
the
skin. This is inoculation, right? This is what
inoculation
this
means. Versus vaccination, right? And so some of the founders were very forward-thinking. Both John Adams and Thomas Jefferson both underwent inoculation as young men. It was a controversial subject at the time. In some states, inoculation was outlawed. We have one of the most vivid descriptions of inoculation from letters that John Adams sent to his then fiancée, Abigail Adams, where he talks about being isolated with his brother and some friends in an inoculation, quote, hospital in the Boston area. And doctors arranged first for them to have a particular diet that they felt would be helpful in taking the inoculation safely. They were also given calomel, that's mercury, to make what they thought make it a better environment for the smallpox inoculation. And Adams talks about how the doctor came over to him. They made a small cut in the skin, inserted the virus, and then covered it with what we would call a bandage. And they were isolated in this so much a quasi-hospital kind of a inoculation clinic for about 10 days because they did not know the exact number of days that these people might be contagious, but they had a fairly good idea.
Do we know today how long they would be contagious if someone were to contract
smallpox? Yeah, they probably would have been contagious up to 14 days, which is rather interesting. During the American Revolution, Abigail Adams went to Boston. John was in Philadelphia in the Continental Congress. She brought her children to Boston to be inoculated because none of them had been previously inoculated. As a child, her parents refused to do that because she had been somewhat of a sickly child and they were concerned. And it's also an interesting story. The children broke out in different stages. Their daughter, Nabby, John nicknamed her his speckled beauty, had a tremendous amount of pustules that broke out. But Abigail went to listen to a public reading of the Declaration of Independence while she probably was still contagious without realizing that.
Wow. And you mentioned that, you know, Abigail's parents wouldn't let her get inoculated because she'd been a sickly child. So that means not everybody in colonial America thought that inoculation was a good idea. Why were some resistant?
Well, again, controversial because sometimes it did result in death. Also, many physicians and medical practitioners were really reluctant to bring new ideas into the discussion. It was so controversial in many ways that Benjamin Franklin and his brother, who was a printer in Massachusetts, disagreed rather violently about whether it was safe or not. Franklin became really one of the greatest advocates of inoculation in America. When he later lived in Philadelphia, where he was, of course, a leading citizen, he actually paid to print 1,500 copies of a pamphlet on inoculation explaining its benefits and the method to inoculate, and he distributed it free at his expense to doctors and other medical practitioners through the colonies.
Wow. Maybe is that part of the reason why he decided he moved to Philadelphia from Boston was because I know he and his brother didn't get along, but maybe the smallpox was...
It wasn't that only, but yes, he kind of chafed under the hand of his older brother and felt that he wanted to be independent on his own and made his way to Philadelphia, where we know he became enormously successful.
So with all this disease in colonial America, do you know about how long the average American in the 18th century would have lived?
Well, those statistics are rather tricky to extrapolate, but I would say on average, the life expectancy for men would probably have been in their 50s. Women, even a lower life expectancy because many women died in childbirth or complications from pregnancy or childbirth. So it obviously varied from person to person. What is very striking is that all of the founders certainly exceeded the life expectancy in general of the time, and they actually did quite well by modern contemporary times. Adams lived to be 90. Jefferson and Franklin both lived into their 80s.
And life expectancy figures, they are hard because it depended on which region you lived in, right?
Correct. The South was notoriously unhealthy, as they put it. People were subject to a number of diseases, such as malaria, that were chronically wore people down. Washington and Madison probably suffered repeated attacks of malaria, which can flare up and then become quiescent over the years.
So say you did contract malaria or another disease, how would 18th century doctors have treated that? Did they have like a common set of practice or protocols for the treatment of illness?
Many would have bled their patients, of course, and they also believed in purging and blistering. But one of the effective medications, although it was not put in pill form as we would have it today, was Peruvian bark, the source for quinine. So malaria is treatable, at least controllable, with quinine. The only thing is they didn't know exactly what a dosage might be. But that was one of the few helpful medications that was available.
And what were their thoughts behind bleeding? Was that to help get the body into equilibrium? Did they
correct,
think that it would
correct.
Expel the disease? Oh, okay.
Yeah. Benjamin Rush, who was probably the most respected physician during colonial and early republic times, he lived in Philadelphia, was a great proponent of bleeding. He actually eventually decided that bleeding was really the first step in almost every disease. And he came to a conclusion, incorrectly, of course, but that blood and its circulation and its overabundance or underabundance could be really traced to the cause of every disease. I think probably the most dramatic example was during the yellow fever epidemic in Philadelphia of 1793. Philadelphia was then the leading city in terms of population, the largest city in colonial. Well, now it wasn't colonial anymore. By 1793 in the early republic, the largest city in America. And its population was about 50,000, 40 to 50,000. During the epidemic, probably as much as 10% of the population died, and thousands more had contracted yellow fever and had recovered. Many
of them
actually
fled. What is yellow fever? It sounds really deadly.
Yellow fever is also a virus, but it is passed instead of by person to person. It is spread by mosquitoes. And again, let me just tell you a little bit about Rush. He was a very devoted, dedicated physician, but he felt as time went on that virulent diseases really had to be treated with very radical measures, heroic measures, as they were called. And he bled sometimes some of his patients 4/5 of their blood taken from them over time. It obviously did nothing to help the yellow fever, curing the yellow fever, but he probably hurried many of their patients to their deaths. And another person who actually surprisingly was a great proponent of bleeding was George Washington. His final demise was due to a complication of a throat infection. But he was bled several times on that last day, and probably his body went into shock, and that was probably the proximate cause of his death.
Were any of the founders against bleeding? I mean, I would have to imagine that somebody would, you know, observe at some point, like, hey, he bled 4/5 out, and, you know, he's really weak now and just barely hanging on.
Right. Well, bleeding was on a spectrum, I would say. Some physicians believed in very radical, extreme bleeding. Some felt little. But there were a number of physicians, particularly of the French school and some in Great Britain, who actually felt that bleeding was harmful. In America, I would say one of the strongest voices against bleeding was Thomas Jefferson. He was a very strong proponent of letting nature take its course. He felt that bleeding did indeed hurry people to their deaths, that it had no benefit whatsoever. Even though he and Rush were great friends, he criticized Rush very strongly for bleeding in general and certainly during the epidemic.
So you have doctors and they're, you know, professionally trained, and you described in your book that a lot of them went to Edinburgh or France or Leiden in the Netherlands to receive their treatment. And I'm wondering, with all that education, we think today of education being very expensive. Could early Americans afford to go and see a professional professional doctor when they took ill? And if they couldn't, you know, how would they deal with disease and illness?
Yeah, most Americans did not resort to a doctor at first and certainly could not afford it. Most families had traditional receipts, as they call it, the recipes for home remedies for many diseases, and some of them may have been more effective than what the physicians had to offer. And many of them also would consult more informal medical practitioners. for instance, doctors in the early years were seldom called in for childbirth, and probably to the benefit of the women giving birth. Midwives usually had more experience and were less likely to spread disease. Physicians would often come from the sick bed and go to another patient and infect that second patient with the disease of the earlier patient. Certainly, in terms of childbirth, often went to the child bed with hands that were full of germs.
Is that just because the doctors were busy, so they were attending more births, or is it because midwives had a sixth sense about germ theory? I know they didn't understand germ theory, but again, if you're in medicine, I have to imagine you're observing things as you go along.
Well, they did not, remember, they did not understand, they had no knowledge at that point of
right.
germ theory. They did not understand that they would be transmitting illness from one person to another, the physicians. Really, probably one of the greatest benefits to medicine was insistence that doctors wash their hands with antiseptics. That didn't come out about till at least the Civil War and probably afterwards. Even in the late 19th century, doctors were still claiming that that was ridiculous. Doctors were gentlemen. They were clean. They didn't have to wash their hands before performing surgery or attending one patient after another. Midwives, first of all, probably put more emphasis on what we would call natural or health medications. Health medicine, but they were not generally treating sick people per se. They were really focused on delivering babies. So although it's possible they went from one childbirth to another, they weren't coming necessarily from a sick bed to the childbed.
Wow, this is really interesting, the world of 18th century medicine. And just to transition a little bit here, just to get more into your book, Revolutionary Medicine, Sergini includes five chapters in Revolutionary Medicine, and each one focuses on a founding father or a founding father and mother pair. She writes about George and Martha Washington, Benjamin Franklin, Abigail and John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, and James and Dolly Madison. Sergini, why did you decide to write about these particular founding father and mother pairs? And I am curious, why did Thomas Jefferson get two chapters?
Okay. When I think about that for a moment, one of the reasons I approached the Washingtons, the Adamses, and the Madisons in Paris is that illness was really very central to their marriages in many ways. Remember that Martha Washington and Dolly Madison were both widows. Martha Washington lost her husband and a child at the same time to some kind of a throat distemper, as they would call it, an infection, and another toddler previously. She came to the marriage as a widow, a very wealthy widow, but she was available because illness had devastated her first family. Dolly Madison has an even more dramatic story. Dolly Madison and her first husband were in Philadelphia during the yellow fever epidemic. Dolly's husband succumbed to yellow fever. Her baby succumbed to yellow fever. She was left, and she was sick, but she recovered. She was left to take care of her toddler. I think he was about two at the time. And she met James Madison in Philadelphia. They married about a year after her husband's death. So I think their medical histories are very relevant as pairs. And John and Abigail Adams, I would say, were certainly a love match and knew each other, you know, from a young age, the first marriage, obviously, for both of them. But they connected through health and illness in so many ways, and they lost several of their children to illness, and the only one of their six children that lived to old age was John Quincy Adams. One of the most dramatic pieces that I read when I was researching the founders all together was the story of Abigail Adams being home, not on her own because her mother and her sisters were with her, but she gave birth to a stillborn baby in 1777 when John was in Philadelphia at the Continental Congress. And she survived, but it was a very wrenching emotional experience. And she wrote John informing him that their stillborn baby, whom they had named Susanna after his mother, you know, that the baby had been born stillborn, but that she was very relieved, obviously, that she was in good health, and she was sure that he would be happy to hear that. And he wrote back, too, and said, and I'm going to quote from this, he wrote and said, "Providence has preserved to me a life," that's Abigail's, "that is dearer to me than all the blessings in the world." And then he went on to observe, "Is it not unaccountable that one should feel so strong an affection for an infant that one has never seen or shall see?" I found that one of the most poignant letters that I came across among the founders. We often think of John Adams as rather a cranky, irascible man, and he was at times, but he was really so profoundly connected to Abigail, and you can see what sadness this particular loss meant to him, and that was not an uncommon occurrence. Childhood mortality in the early years of in colonial America and the early republic was very high, probably as much as one quarter of children under two perished.
And that's what one of the things I liked about your book was not only does it have great information about medicine in the 18th century and how the founders viewed it, but you really humanize the founders too by looking at their interactions with death, and almost all of them lost children. So, you know, it's a very emotional thing. And as we just saw through your quote, it affected them deeply.
Yes, I'll just interject for a minute. I mean, I would say Thomas Jefferson certainly rivaled all of them in loss. He lost his wife when she was only in her late 20s, a very beloved wife, to illness, and five of his six children predeceased him. He was a very emotional person. It was brought great grief to him, and I think it probably made him more sensitive to issues of health and preventative medicine.
Wow. Well, I have a lot of questions, and we're unfortunately not going to get a chance to get to them because I want to be respectful of your time. But before we go, we have a special fun section called the Time Warp.
The Time Warp. Historians can't predict the future, but they can speculate about what might have been.
And this is a fun segment of the show where we ask you a hypothetical history question about what might have happened if something had occurred differently or if someone had acted differently. So I'd like to ask you that question. Are you ready?
Sure.
So in your first chapter, you discuss the importance of George Washington's decision to inoculate the Continental Army from smallpox. In your opinion, what might have happened if Washington had not ordered the inoculation of the Continental Army?
Well, the short answer is that I think we probably would still be British citizens. The smallpox was raging through the army. Many of the recruits were particularly young men from rural areas who had never encountered smallpox before. Both Washington and Adams remarked in several letters that they had more to fear from smallpox than from the British. And I believe that John Adams said that they lost 10 soldiers to smallpox for every one they lost to the British. So I don't think we could minimize that. I think that he actually, by ordering the inoculation, and still people slipped through the cracks, and there was still some illness that was spread, but I think he was able to stem that tremendous epidemic, which helped the army to survive and ultimately triumph against the British.
Wow, that's a huge contribution. If you know, given that the Continental Army, I guess if smallpox had raged, then there wouldn't have been anyone to fight the British.
Yeah, I think it's really one of the unheralded accomplishments of Washington.
Wow. Well, thank you so much for speaking to us today. I really enjoyed our conversation, and your book is really rich with detail. So hopefully if listeners want to know more about revolutionary medicine, medicine in the 18th century, they can take a look at your book. But before we conclude, can you tell us about your current research project or historical endeavors?
Oh, I'm still working a little bit in the area of medicine. Right now, I'm just starting to do research on an article or a possible book on the history of measles in the United States, a rather unappreciated illness, one that we think of as being just, inconvenient childhood disease. But in the early years and really until there was an effective vaccine in the 1960s, it really played havoc with American life.
And it's a timely topic too, because every once in a while, even today, you hear flare-ups of measles. So
yes,
it'll be
and
good
it's
to know
still
more
a tremendous, a tremendous cause of illness and mortality in developing countries even today.
And if we wanted to find more information about you and your work and how to get in contact with you, where's the best place for people to look for that information?
Well, I think they really could just go on the University of Denver website and contact me by email, but I have a very easy email. I will give it to your listeners right now. They can
sure.
contact me at jabrams, J-A-B-R-A-M-S, at du.edu.
Great. And we will certainly link that in our show notes, which will be posted with this episode. So thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Liz. It's been a pleasure speaking with you.
Wow. That was a really interesting conversation, wasn't it? Jeannie deepened my knowledge about how 18th century Americans understood disease, and she shed light on how disease and illness affected the lives of the founding fathers and mothers, a topic which she covers at greater length in her book. You can find more information about Jeannie, her book, Revolutionary Medicine, plus everything we talked about today on the show notes page for this episode, which you'll find at benfranklinsworld.com/005. If you enjoyed today's show, please tell your friends about us. We won't be on iTunes or Stitcher until December, so please send them to benfranklinsworld.com so they can discover more about the show and download all of our episodes. And finally, if you have any questions, comments, or suggestions about the show, or what I could do to improve it, please send me an email to liz@benfranklinsworld.com or tweet me at Liz Kovart.
And remember, never leave till tomorrow that which you can do today.